Thanks. So first, I would like to thank the organizers for the very nice tutorials and very interesting conference and for this invitation. So André Joyal has already presented the univalence axiom. And he has explained that Wojewski proved that we have a model of this axiom in a notion of space, where a space is a simplicial complex, can simplicial set. So so as I will explain, so there are, so this when we look at this argument, actually it's not intuitionistically valid, so it cannot be done in an arbitrary topos. So the main goal of this this talk is to present intuitionistically valid notion of space, so notion of homotopy type. The plan of the talk is, so first I will explain why this univalence axiom is really important in logic, so a complement of André Joyal's presentation. Then I will explain why simplicial set, can simplicial set are intrinsically classical, used in an intrinsical way, classical logic, and then I will present this an alternative notion of homotopy type. First, I recall the definition that André presented of characterization of topos. So topos is a presentable locally Cartesian closed category with a subobject classifier. And André started to explain to which set theory this corresponds to. So I will do this by using instead type theory. So, it's a Grothendieck topos because there is presentable in this characterization. So, and what I present now is what kind of set theory or logic correspond to this this notion. So, locally Cartesian closed. So, in particular, so it's Cartesian closed. So it has exponential. And so there is actually, so in the 40s, so logician, so Alonzo Church, designed a very simple, very elegant formal system, so called the simple theory of type, which correspond actually to logic, the set theory that André presented. So this is, so what is this logic? So you have a type of proposition. So, Church was working in a classical framework, so this type was, he thought of this as a type with only 0, 1, but for a topos, so this will be the subobject classifier of the topos. And then we have a type of individuals, and the only formation that we have for building new type is the function type. So, this type theory has a very natural set theoretic semantics.
What does it mean from external? A type for individuals. What does it mean?
We fix so typical. I is a type of natural number. For instance, so we fix the best type, and so for Church, it was Church was not really using. He was using a type of individual. He had an axiom that this type was infinite, an infinity axiom, and from this is what he was building a type of natural number. Yes, so power set will be I arrow bool. So bool is a type of proposition. And Church didn't have Cartesian product. You can add a Cartesian product to this if you want a good correspondence with a Cartesian closed category.
In some places they said, I'm not a logician, but a simple theory of type is kind of built by some basic sets and then power set and Cartesian product, so there is this kind of notion.
Yeah, so there is an alternative presentation where you don't have a function type, but you have only Cartesian product and power set. And this is usually, in Lambeck and Scott, for instance, a book, Categorical Logic by Lambeck and Scott, they use this formulation of type theory. But actually, I want to use this formulation because I want to stress that in this formulation, so there are two notions of functions. So one notion of function is given by this primitive type. And there is another notion of function, which is a usual notion of function in set theory or in mathematics, actually. So it's a function which is given by a functional graph. So in such system, there is a question to relate this notion of function given by a functional graph and this notion of primitive function. And this is done by, so that's what I write here. And what is the connection between these two notions? So so if we have, for having a good connection between these two notions, we need to introduce an operator, which is known as a description operator. So iota of x. And this is needed to connect the notion of function and the notion of functional graph. And this notion of operation, I mean, it's fundamental in mathematics. It represents, so if we look at this, so it says that if you have unique existence, then you have an object which satisfies this. So it corresponds to, in mathematics, to giving a name to an object if you you know that this object, you have a property which is, you know, is satisfied by only one element, then you can give a name to this object. So, in Bourbaki, they use a stronger operation that they wrote tau operations, so which is a form, a strong form of axiom of choice. But so Bourbaki write tau, but usually, so in logic, it's called, and Hilbert called it epsilon operation, so which is a strong form of axiom of choice. So if you have existence, then you can give a name to this this object. But Church, and so if you have this, actually, this implies classical logic. So Church had a weaker, introduced a weaker operations. If you have unique existence, then you can give a name to this object. And this operation, so as I said, it's fundamental. And I think, so that's why this title, Logic and Topology. So this operation is fundamental in logic, but I think it's only through the work of work of Voivodsky that we start to have a mathematical analysis of what's going on in this operation. as I said, this operation is use unique existence. So unique existence it presupposes the notion of equality. So how equality is represented in this formal system? So it can be characterized. I mean, it can be defined in this system, but it can be also characterized by two axioms. So the first one is that it's reflexive, and the second one is that you have the substitutivity property. So if A0 and A1 are equal, any property of A0 is satisfied by A1. Okay. And then you have, like in set theory, so the first axiom in set theory is the axiom of extensionality. So like in set theory, you have an extensionality axiom. And there are two forms of this extensionality axiom. So the one that you expect, which is that if you have two functions from A to B that are pointwise equal, then they are equal. And the second form, so it's a little less expected, it says that if you have two propositions that are equal, then that are logically equivalent, sorry, then these propositions are equal. Okay. So that's so the univalence, so these axioms in this formal system, so they are independent. But so the univalence axiom, as we are going to see, is a generalization of one, okay, this form of extensionality. And in the setting that I will present now, this generalization of one implies two. So it's very, really a strong form of extensionality. So as André said, so in this set theory corresponding to topos theory, so what we can form is we can iterate power set. So we can form the power set of I, power set of power set, and so on. But we cannot talk internally about the family of such type. So we don't have, in Zermelo-Frankel set theory, so this is axiom of replacement that allows to do this, to talk about this family.
In simple type theory, you cannot.
Yeah, in simple type theory, you cannot. Yeah. So the refinement of type theory is that I will present. In the refinement of type theory I will present, you can do it. And more importantly, so if you want to represent mathematics in this formal system, you cannot talk or introduce an arbitrary structure. So you can fix a structure on the type I or on the type I Haubul, but you cannot introduce let X be a type and let we consider a structure on X. Okay, and this is a really strong limitation if you want to talk about arbitrary structure or arbitrary ring, arbitrary group, and prove things about groups. So people have designed an extension of type theory, which is so where you refine the notion of type with dependent types. So what is so now what is basic? So I will not give the details, formal details of this system, but the main idea is that what is basic in this formal system is the notion of family of types. Okay, and already so in this notation, so you see the analog of so when you have a fibration. So over a type, so it's natural to look at so if A is a point of A, to look at the fiber over A. Okay, so that's the same. So I mean that's the same notation which is used in this type theory. So I mean it's not unexpected that this formal system will have connection with the notion of fibration. And actually, this formal system is a kind of minimal formal system in which you can talk about the notion of fibration. Okay. And in this formal system, so you have primitive operations that are derived operations in set theory. So what are these primitive operations? So I will use this. And these are actually the same notations as the one used in Bourbaki in set theory. So this is a set of sections if you have a family of type. This is a type of section of this family. Okay, and this is a type of pair AB where A is in A and B is in B of A. So in set theory, I mean, usually this is considered in this case. So you have a family of type and you form the disjoint sum and a set of sections. So this is a purely formal generalization. So I know you to types instead of sets. And so what has been noticed is that actually you can explain logical operations, or you can reduce logical operations to purely operations on types by the following dictionary. So you define the Cartesian product, or so which correspond to the conjunctions to in the non-dependent case, and the function types is a non-dependent function case. And then you, so if you see a proposition, so the idea is to see a proposition as a type of its proof. So if you have this view, then you can look at for all as being represented by this dependent product, and a very strong form of existence as being represented by this sigma type. So, and this was done so in a long time ago, so by mathematician De Bruyne, who noticed that actually this formal system is suitable for representation of mathematical proofs on a computer. So this has so nothing to do with fibration at this point. Okay, and this is really nice actual description of Knuth of what's going on. So I mean, what I find interesting is that so this is a logic-free presentation of logic. I mean, you have all you do is that you build elements of a type, and you don't have to explain logical rules. So in Church, he had to list all logical rules, and there you don't need to list logical rules. I mean, they are part of the formalism. So what is the source of real dependent types? I mean, how do you introduce real dependent types? So there are two sources: universes and path types. So usually it's called identity type, but since we want to see the connection with topology, I will call them path type. So what are universe? So universe, so it has been also, universe has been introduced by De Bruyne and by Martin Loff. So universe is a type which is represent types. So it's a type, the elements are types, of this type are types, and it's closed by the following operation. So in this kind of formalism, so Russell's paradox does not apply directly, but Jean-Yves Girard was able actually to represent Burali-Forti paradox.
Can you remind us what is a Burali-Forti? I mean, the Russell we know.
Yeah, so Burali-Forti is ordinals of all ordinals, or well-founded, actually for Girard it was kind of well-founded type of well-founded relation of all well-founded relations. And so Girard was able to show how to represent this paradox in if you have a type of all types. So it's similar to set theory. You cannot have a set of all sets. So Martin Loff, so actually, and following Grothendieck explicitly, he mentioned Grothendieck explicitly, introduced instead a hierarchy of universes. So U0, U1, to and external. And each universe UN is closed by these operations, but UN contains UN minus one. And
UN contains UN minus one as an element.
As an element.
And not as a circle.
Not as a. But it's also so if you have a type, any type in U0 is also a type in U1, and so on. So it's very natural, actually, by analogy with set theory. Okay, so with this, you can represent the notion of structure, so mathematical structure. So because you can. Now you have this type U0, so you can introduce an arbitrary X in U0 and a structure on X. So this type, for instance, it will represent the collection of types in U0, so small type, with a binary operation, so X times X in X, and a constant in X.
When you say structure, you mean the structure of the smallest type? Because can I introduce, for instance, Hilbert spaces?
So you can, I mean, if you want, you can define real numbers, or, for instance, Cauchy sequence, and then you have a type of, you will have the type of Hilbert spaces. And this is this kind of representation which is used by Girard for expressing Burali-Forti paradox. So, but if you want to introduce a group, for instance, you will have equalities on this binary operation. So you need a notion of equality, and this was a really important contribution of. So Martin Loff, who introduced, give laws for a notion of equality, but no equality, so it has to be thought of as a dependent type. So this will be the type of equality between A and B. So an element of this type represents an equality between A and B. So it's natural to think of this as a path connecting A and B. If we think if we look at type as spaces.
Equality is typed.
Equality is typed. Yes, that's really important. So you don't have a global notion of equality.
One of the weak points of classical exposition.
Yeah, because we don't have that in set theory.
Yes. And this equality. I mean, if you look now at the rule of equality. It's really similar to what you have for path. So like for path, so you have a constant path between A and A, which corresponds to the proof of reflexivity. And if you have a path connecting A and B, I mean, I said that if A and B are equal, any property of A is a property of B. Now you can look at this as if you have a path between A and B, then you have a way to transport any element of this to an element of this. So this is exactly, so if you look at this picture, I mean, this is exactly the path lifting property. Yeah.
So if you normally we would say that CA, or if CA is true, then CB is true.
Yeah.
But now you have a map sort of proving that this is true and this is
the transport.
Yes, exactly.
Not transform the proof of CA.
Is C just any dependent type over A, or is it?
Yes. So C of A is no any dependent type over A. So in particular, it can be a structure, a mathematical structure, which varies with A. So we have really a transport map between this structure in A and the structure in B. So and now, so that's remarkable about remarkable contribution of Wawelski. So he was able to use this formal system that exists already, and he was able to formulate so some very simple and natural definition, which correspond to actually important fact in topology. So for instance, so he defined that he defined, so if A is a type, so A is, on, is in some universe, you define the type, which means that A is contractible. So, and what does it mean? It means that you have a point in A, so that any other point in A is equal to, you have a path between A and X. Okay, but a proof of this fact is a witness that space A is contractible. Then you define the fiber, so if F is a map from T to A, and A, little a, is a point in A, the fiber, so how will you define the fiber? So it's
you mean you are imagining that the spaces you are working with are all CAN complex?
Yes. Yeah, so that's.
So yeah. Not arbitrary spaces.
No, no,
the
CAN complex.
Because then the fibration is
out. Yes, yes. So you imagine so the types are CAN complexes, and a dependent type corresponds to a CAN fibration. CAN fibration.
Yeah.
Maps are more general.
Maps are more general, I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
Why the first thing cannot be an empty thing? Like
no, because there exists.
Yeah. Yeah. So you, so if you have this, you have the witness A. So you have a pair. So you have the witness A. So it's non-empty. So if you have a proof that A is contractible, so actually you have a, so that will be come later. So you have a map from is contre A to A. Which so if you have a proof that A is contractible, then you have an element in A, and that's simply the first projection. So and then you define when a map. So
the second will be called the homotopy fiber
yes,
of the map.
Yes, homotopy. Exactly.
Okay. Yeah. And where are the co-fibrations?
Yes. So that's that will be yeah. So the, this will come actually. That's a crucial point, and yes, it will come later. So the co-fibrations were not there in the in this formal system. Yeah, so, but they will come later. And then you have when F, so if F is a map from T to A, you can define when F is an equivalence. And this is simply that, so for all A in A, the fiber is contractible. And then you can define the space of equivalence between T and A as this sigma type. So an equivalence is a pair. So it's a function from T to A and a proof that F is an equivalence. Then you define when a type is a proposition. So type is a proposition if any two elements are equal. You can define when a type is a set as the type space of path is a proposition. And then you can define when a type is a groupoid and so on.
Which means that equality is decidable so intuitively.
No, so that, no, no. So that's, and so to be a set, it means, so you are in an intuitionistic framework. It means that you have at most a path between two points. And you have also the notion of decidable type. So this will be, so you have this, so you have path X, AB, plus so negation of path X, AB. So if you have a proof of this for all AB in A, X, sorry, mean X. So, and this is defined as being the implication path. So this is itself a space, which is a space of this space, okay? Where this is the empty type. Okay, so this will be, X is decidable. And one of the first theorem of this formalism is that if a type is decidable, then it is a set. And it is a remarkable theorem because it connects a logical notion and a homotopic notion.
In the CAN model, the sets are essentially the discrete space, right?
Yeah. What? Yes.
Yeah, you mean because you have a unique path?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
What is what again?
Sorry? What is, oh, the first one?
Is what? Maybe.
Is contractible.
Is contractible, sorry. So, and actually, so...
you're missing one, no? I know, sorry.
Sorry, sorry. And the convention is whenever you have is something, actually, this type is a proposition. So that's so this is so for instance you can prove that for any A, so this type is always a proposition. And for any F, this type is a proposition.
What is the origin of the is?
Yes, so is is a proposition, it means. And or is contractible type, yes. And so yes, and that's Voivodsky's convention. So whenever you write something like that, it is this type is a proposition. And so the axiom he formulated are propositions themselves. And so just to give an example, so I mean, so in topology, so whenever you have two vibrations over a type, a space A, so sorry, yeah, you have two, you have E and F, I mean, and then you give a map between each fibers, continuous in A. So then you can define a corresponding map on the total space. Then it's a theorem that, I mean, this map on total space is an equivalence if and only if for each A you have an equivalence. Okay.
So something is an equivalence if it is fiber-wise an equivalence.
Yes, yes. And this is a theorem so which you find in textbook in algebraic topology. And Voivodsky so was able to prove it in this formal system by purely syntactical manipulation. So you can prove this. And so when you have also, so this notion of equivalence, it's a very strong notion. I mean, you can show, of course, what you expect is that if a map between T and A is an equivalence, then it has an inverse. So in particular, it's a logical, any equivalence is a logical equivalence. And logical equivalence only means that you have map in both directions. But if you have two types that are propositions, then the notion of logical equivalence coincide with the notion of equivalence. Okay. So here you have two types that are propositions, then this logical equivalence is actually an equivalence between the two types. And this will play a role in actually this in the formulation of the univalence axiom. So another fact about equality type is that so with this notation, so Martin Lof and for purely logical reason, yes, introduce this law, so which means that for any type A, so you have a new law. I mean, this is really a new logical law about equality. It says that for any A, this type is contractible. Okay, and what is this type? So this expresses topologically. This expresses that the total space of a vibration defined by the space of path having a given origin is contractible. So, I mean, this fact was mentioned actually in Pierre Cartier.
So you're saying that this was introduced as an axiom?
This was introduced as a law, I mean, as a fact that should hold for the equality.
Not as an axiom.
Not as an axiom, yeah.
But as a deduction principle.
As a deduction principle, yes, it was. Okay. Yeah. And this plays actually, this fact plays really an important role in all, for instance, in the proof of this this theorem. So you have to use this fact. And this fact so, was introduced for purely logical reason by Martin Lof. And what is remarkable is that it this fact actually topologically, this is exactly the starting point of the loop space method in algebraic topology, okay, as was already mentioned.
Martin Lof had not topological interpretations in mind when he wrote that.
No,
he would not write Pat, for example, not write I is contractible.
Exactly, yes. So this is formulated using the notations introduced by Voivodsky, yes.
So in some sense, we could say that he did not understand what he was doing.
It's deeply built into human brain.
Yeah. Even in the brain of logician, it's
there. No, I can come to the so the statement of univalence. So, so first, I mean, a form which is close to the one. I mean, which is one of Voivodsky, and so it says that actually, so. I mean, this type, the universe U, so you have a vibration on U, which is simply, X. So a point of U is a type. So you have over U, you have X. So you have this sigma X in U. This is a total space of this vibration. Okay. And so axiom of univalence states that this this vibration is univalent in the sense that André described. So, and the formulation of Voivodsky was that, so if you have a path, so an equality between A and B, then so you can prove that A and B are equivalent simply because A is equivalent to A, and the equality is a least reflexive relation. So you have this, and the formulation is that this canonical map is an equivalence. And I will use another formulation, which is equivalent, which is which has been noticed first by Martin Escardo, which is, so another equivalent statement is this fact. So if you look, so we know that if we look at this set, so by the law of Martinov, so that this type is contractible. We know that this type is contractible. So what happens if you replace path by equiv? So you get another type, which is this one, equiv AX. Okay. And one possible way to formulate the axiom of univalence axiom is that this type is contractible. And now, if you look at this, so this, I mean, you have these two types that depend on A. Okay. So you have the situations that you have two family of types between for A and U. So actually, if you have a map from path to equiv, and any map, actually, which is generic, so which is uniform in A and X, any map will be an equivalence by the theorem of on equivalence on total space, because you have two contractible types. So any map between two contractible types is an equivalence. So if you have this axiom, this formulation is actually equivalent to this one.
So that means that if you fix a type in the universe and look at everything isomorphic to it, equipped with an isomorphism, I say
isomorphism,
then this big star, it's a kind of star,
yeah.
Is contractible.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Topologically contractible.
Okay. So now, what's the connection with axiom of description? So, I mean, really, you can see this type, so which is a proposition in the formal sense that any two elements of this is equal. It's actually a uniform generalization of unique existence. So, I mean, when you say that this type is contractible, I mean, you can define this as being this type. And in, as I said, so if you have is contr of T, then you have is contr of T implies T by first projection. So you have, in a direct way, you have a description operation because this type is implies this one. Okay. So if you have a proof of unique existence, then you get a proof of this sigma type. Hence, by first projection, you get an element. So this is... So unique existence implies effective existence.
So this seems to say that if you have a fibration and you look at the fibers which are contractible, then this fibration will have a section, is it that?
No,
because
you have sections over the support, over the place where it's contractible.
Yeah, it's contractible. Yeah.
This correct?
I don't know because... no, I'm confused. So, can you say it again?
Well, if you have a fibration,
yeah. So this B, so yeah, total space of the fibration.
You look at the points in A. The A is the basis of the fibration.
Yeah.
Where the fiber is as a is contractible.
No. So that's not this. No, you say something about the total space of the fibration. So that's. So to say that the total space is contractible, this is unique existence.
And then?
So there's a union of all fibers which are contractible. I think that's that.
Yes. I mean, you take, yes.
You reduce the vibration, and now it has a section.
Yeah. But I mean, what I want to stress is that so this notion of equivalence, it's really generalized. It's more than unique existence in a set. So it will be unique existence up to isomorphism, unique existence in a categorical level, two categorical level, unique existence up to equivalence, and so on. So it's really. So we have, we can say that we have an explanation of description operation. So now, what is the model of this? So in the 50s, so there was development of combinatorial notion of space. So for instance, I mean, the title of Daniel Kahn's paper is a combinatorial definition of homotopy groups. So first with a cubical set, and then with simplicial set. And one first surprise in this notion of space, it was noticed by Moore in a seminar in 55, is that the space, actually, contrary to the usual topological space, they form a Cartesian closed category. So they are closed by exponential.
Moore is John Moore, I suppose.
Yeah, John Moore.
John Moore.
And it's both in the Carton seminar.
Yes, so I will actually, yes. Yeah, so that, yes. Sorry?
Was
oh, yeah, okay, good. Because, yes. And so this result is actually in germ. It contains Voivodsky's result that actually these spaces form a model of type theory with univalent axioms. And actually, so that was the first result that I wanted to understand. And so, in particular, so this is, if you look at the proof of this, so in the, this Cartan seminar, yeah. So actually, Henri Cartan gave a talk about this result, and he presented his version of proof by.
So what was the Moore
theorem? That you have exponential, yeah, and you have more refined version of this. But actually, he describes this proof as assez technique and delicate. And if you look at the proof, so I mean, it's really technically involved. And if you want this to be a basic result about logic. I mean, you want a more a simpler justification of this. And then you don't need, for a model of type theory, you need actually this space are locally Cartesian closed, so which correspond to dependent product. And if you look at this in the, what it means, so you see, so if you look at this, you see it reduces to the fact that the trivial cofibrations are stable under pullback, so long Kahn vibration. And this fact, so which is considered as basic in people which work with Kahn complexes, I mean, the proof is actually quite complex if you look at it. And I think so. There is a proof with minimal vibrations. Yes. Thanks. Yeah. Yes. But I mean, the proofs are complex. And so we would like to have more, I mean, simpler argument for this. So, I mean, one can see, think that maybe, so we are not clever enough, and maybe we have not found a simpler argument for this. But actually, so there is a negative theorems that all these results, so they are intrinsically non-effective. So it's not a question of that you didn't find the right proof, is that actually they are not provable intuitionistically. So even if you use the very strong intuitionistic system, like intuitionistic version of Zermelo-Frankel, you can prove that following really basic facts are not provable. So this theorem that Kahn's complex are closed by exponentiation, this is not provable, provably not provable. And if you have a vibration, so something really completely basic, so if you have a vibration and two paths connected point in the base, then you expect the fibers to be homotopy equivalent. And sorry?
What do you mean by vibration?
Kahn vibration, yeah. Kahn vibration, if you have a Kahn
vibration. The problem is the excluded middle or the axiom of choice?
Yeah, so, yes, exactly. So you can think that problem is because when you formulate the Kahn complex, you say there exists.
And if you have kind of effective feeling.
Yeah, effective feeling. So you can think this. But actually, this result holds even if you give effectively the feeling. So that's not.
So even if you say that the odds are
explicitly given, it's not enough. Yeah, it's not. Yeah. So that's so there are very strong negative result. And but when you look at this, so at least intuitively for me, so looking at the proof, the reason is that all these arguments actually they use reasoning by case, whether a complex is degenerate or not. Okay. So that's and this you see already. So in the thesis of Jean-Pierre Serre, I mean, he has a part where all the reasoning are, is this cube is degenerate, you do this, is, if it's not degenerate.
Whether a simplex is degenerate or not?
Yes, a simplex. Yeah, a cube. For Serre, it was a cube, and delta n, I mean, you ask, is there a simplex? Yes. Right. Yeah, it's going to be simplex. Yeah. And this is not decidable in general, I mean, as soon as you have exponential. So the, and also, mathematically, so this reflects the fact that the arguments are not uniform and are not elementary. So what I will present so, is how to make these arguments uniform. So that's good. So that's so I will now present a possible effective combinatorial notion of space, which hopefully so gives where all the arguments are no elementary about this. And so what I want is a notion of space which is really as simple as possible, but for what I want to do. Okay, not I don't claim this is what people want to do in algebraic topology. Yeah, homotopy type. Yeah, homotopy type. And it should be simple for what? For getting a model of type theory. Maybe not for developing algebraic topology. This I don't. Probably not. But. Okay. So let's. So I will work with cubes because it's more convenient for. Model of type theory, and I will. what I want, I want a combinatorial representation of this collection of cubes. So if I is a finite set, I want a formal representation of this cube. And what I will use is algebraic property of 0, 1. So it's not max plus algebra this time, but it's. I mean, it's something which is called De Morgan algebra, but it's really very close to distributive lattice. So it's De Morgan algebra is a bounded distributive lattice.
Can you say what you mean by 0, 1?
Unit interval 0, 1. So I want to represent this, but in a combinatorial way. So I want, and more generally, what I want is if I is a finite set, I want a combinatorial representation of this. So the category of cube will be represent. Combinatorially, this one. And what I. So, 0, 1 has a structure of De Morgan algebra. So, De Morgan algebra is a bounded distributive lattice with a De Morgan evolution. So, what is a De Morgan evolution? It's. I mean, I will write it like that. So, it swaps AND and OR. So, it's 1 minus 0 is 1. 1 minus 1 is 0. It swaps. And then 1 minus A and B is 1 minus A sup. 1 minus b.
You have two
operations
of the lattice.
I mean. Yeah, of the lattice, yes. And you have this this axiom. That's what is a De Morgan algebra.
So it's an ANT as a morphism of the distributive lattice
yes.
Itself?
Yes.
Involutive?
Involutive. And it's involutive, so you have 1 minus a equal a.
So you don't put that. Complement of a intersection.
Exactly. So I don't have, in general, I don't have this. Okay, and I will not have this also, in general. And so what is the prime example of De Morgan algebra? It's actually the unit interval 0, 1 with a max and min operation. Sure. So this is a bounded distributive lattice, and this operation is satisfy all these axioms. So that's what I will use of 0, 1 to represent formally what is this category of cubes. So, I mean, this is a purely algebraic notion, like algebraic lattice. So I write DM of S is a free De Morgan algebra on S. And as for distributive lattice, if S is finite, DM of S is finite.
But how do I know it's 0, 1 and not the finite set, for instance, not the finite from 0 to
Yeah, well, this will come from the... I mean, I want as good as possible, purely combinatorial representation of this.
How do I know it's a field?
Well, you will, yeah.
Like a treatment, how many elements has 10 elements, for
example? Yeah, so that's... So if you have 10 elements, then you... I mean, you have this Dedekind number for the number of the bounded free distributive lattice on a finite set n. So on 10 elements, it will be the Dedekind number of 20. It's your double each time. So on, so the free distribution, I mean, the free, if you have only one element, if you have one element, so the what is a free Domorgan algebra is you have I, 1 minus I, then you have the conjunction, you have 0, and you have the disjunction, and you have 1. So you have, in this case, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 elements, which is the Dedekind of 2. I mean, that's the number of elements of the free distributive lattice on 2 elements. So it's so actually to build this free distributive free Domorgan algebra, it's like building the free distributive lattice, and you have a copy. Yeah. So this defines the a monad on the category of finite sets. And so C, this category of cube, will be the opposite of the classic category of DM. So what do I mean by that? So I mean, what is a map from G to I in C? It's a set theoretic map from I to the free Domorgan algebra on J.
So you're taking sort of the dual category?
Yeah.
So you may think of, like in scheme theory, the symmetric lattice and the Morgan lattice are like rings, and you're taking the opposite.
Yeah, yeah, if you want, yeah. So that's, so, and but what it amounts to is that I will describe operations that are invariant by reparametrization, where in the reparametrization, all I can do is to use max, min, and y man, 1 minus x. That's... I mean, what I want to capture formally. Okay, so a cubical set will be a preshift on this base category. So concretely, so it's a family of sets with transition functions from xi to xj for this. Yeah.
To the composition of the map, you use the Monad Schutter?
Yes, I mean, I use usual, I mean, that's this. So which correspond to, I mean, concretely, what you want to do when you reparametrize using max and min, and then you compose this. So, I mean, as usual, I think, so at least there was one speaker also doing this, so I will identify an object of the base category with a representable functor it defines. So if I is a finite set, I will write also I, the representable functor it defines. So now what I'm so I'm working with this base category C, and I'm working in the so preshift category over C, and that's what is a cubical set. Okay, so now I have this formal representation of each finite set I. I look at this representable functor as a formal representation of the cube on I. Okay, and so as maps, for instance, an example of a map that I have is is this face map. So since I can send I to zero and all the elements to themselves, so I get a face map like this that are monos in this category. And I get so usual decomposition of any morphism is decomposed uniquely as a face map with a map, which is strict. I mean, like, all these facts are purely elementary, and I mean, there is nothing. But now, what is a singular cubical set? So since 0, 1 has a Domorgan algebra structure, so I can define the functor from C to top, which to I associate 0, 1 to the I. So what? And so any topological space X defines a singular cubical set S of X, with S of X of I is a set of continuous map from 0, 1, I to X.
And I suppose this would be Kahn.
Yes, so that's exactly, yeah. So that's, so, and but Kahn with a reformulation of Kahn, so that way, so because So if we use Kahn with the usual definition, even giving explicitly the fillers, this will not work constructively. So I want to have more structure on this. So a fundamental cubical set. Sorry?
Wait, in the slide before, yeah. When you say 0, 1 to the I mapping to x, is that the real interval 0, 1?
Yes, so that's a real interval, real unit interval. Yeah.
But what is your I in the, where is that in the real interval? Don't we need to say where I is?
So I is a finite set.
No, the little I in the De Morgan algebra?
Yeah.
Don't you need to specify where that is?
No. I send I to this, to each object of the base category. I associate this topological
the little
space.
I, the element of the free De Morgan algebra.
Yeah.
Don't you need to say what value that has in the?
No, I don't. No. I define it. I define this functor from C to top in this way.
So I don't see how you get maps because.
Okay. So yes,
this functor should be covariant, right?
Yes, it's covariant.
So what's confusing is that you write it as an exponentiation and normally.
Oh, okay. Yes, that's right. Yes. Okay.
I is the Morgan algebra, and you're looking at the. You're looking at the maps from the De Morgan algebra I to.
Yes. So. So what are the maps? Yes. So it's a covariant functor. You said so. If I have a map from, I will probably get confused. But a map from I to J is a set theoretic map from J to De Morgan, free De Morgan algebra on I. Okay. So by contravariance, I get a map from this to this to J. Right. And then, because this is a De Morgan algebra, to get a map from the free De Morgan algebra on I to 0, 1, it's enough to give a map from I to 0, 1. So any map from I to 0, 1 gives a map from 0, 1 to De Morgan of I.
Here, I is an abstract notion.
It's a finite set, yeah.
It's
purely symbolic. Yeah. So then I get a map from this to this, and this is the map which defines the C to top. An important cubical set is I of J called De Morgan of J. Okay, so that's this is also this defines preshift, and this is a representation of the interval. Okay. And what is where I get so this framework is so it's convenient for what I want to do is that I have a very simple, actually and intuitive representation of the pace. Path space. Okay, so what is x to the I? X to the I of J. So I have, this intuitively it should correspond to I have two cubes of dimension J, and I should have a cube of higher dimension which connects them. And this is exactly what you get with this path. So x I to J is essentially given by a cube of higher dimension. Okay, that's, so this is really, this is there, it's much better, much nicer for what I want to do than a simplicial set, because the simplicial set, the path exponential with delta 1 is a little more complex to describe. Also what I get for free is this fundamental fact that this path is contractible. I get it already at the level of cubical set without the Kahn condition. Because what it is, it's an homotopy between a constant path and an arbitrary path. Okay, and this is exactly the square. So this is where I use this mean operation. Okay, so to any path, I can associate an homotopy between constant path and the path speed. Yeah, for free, yes. This is given by the De Morgan algebra structure. Okay, so this is the first lattice, which is important. And then, so now I have another So there will be two objects that are important. So I have, how much time do I have? Sorry. 5 minutes, yeah, okay. So there are two, I mean, actually three objects that will play the role. So there is this interval, and then there is, as always, there is a sub-object classifier. And then in I, I have two global elements, 0 and 1. Okay. And then, so I have a map, as usual, I have a map which is internally it's defined as a truth value of I equal 1 from I to I. And I can look at the image of this map. Okay, and that defines, and this map is a lattice map. Okay. So, and I can define that, look at the image of this map. And this will be a sub sub pre-sheaf of omega. And that will be the what I call the face lattice, because it's actually the lattice which is generated. So it's a set of sieves. And they are exactly the sieves that are generated by faces, union of faces. Okay, so I get a union of faces, which will play a fundamental role. So f of I is a set. So intuitively, so I of j, so I represents the interval, and this represents so the face lattice. So f of I, actually, if I look at it, so this will be correspond to the lattice of subpolyhedron of a cube, of the cube 0, 1 to the I. Okay. And that's what I need in order to state the Kahn condition. Yeah, Kahn condition. So, yes, and this lattice can be defined directly as a free bounded distributive lattice generated by this formal symbol and this relation. And this is where cofibration will come. So, F will classify cofibrations, intuitively at least. So any map which is classified by F will be a cofibration. So that's, and constructively, so we cannot hope like in a simplicial set in the classical framework, so all monos are cofibration. But this is too strong. I mean, this we cannot hope. So if I have a, so no, if so I will simply formulate the Kahn condition for this and for this. For relative to this notion of subpolyhedron. So whenever I have a map from I to F, psi, so this defines a sub-object, since F is a sub-object of omega, so I get a sub-object of I. So intuitive, so geometrically, so this is a representation of the cube, 0, 1 to the I, and this is a representation of sub-faces of this cube. So that's okay. So what I will say, I will state that this map is a cofibration. Okay, but not directly. So I will say, I give only the example of what it means to be contractible, and I will stop with this. So. So what is the usual notion of contractibility? So the usual notion of contractibility is that if you have, so you have X, cubical set, and then you want to say that X is contractible. So what you say usually is that if you have a map from a sub-polyhedron of the cube, so you have always inclusion, then you can extend this map to a total map. I mean, you can fill any subpolyhedron of the cube. Okay, so what I ask is a refinement of this, which is uniform in I. So what I say is that if I have another object J and a map in the category, base category from F to G to I, so I can pull back this. So I get J psi F. Okay, so I will have another. So by composition, I will get this map. I will have another extension here. And what I ask is, I don't give only one extension punctually, but I give a uniform collection of extensions. So I ask that for each f, I give, I mean, that's the definition here. So we have an operation which is uniform, which gives this filling uniformly. Okay, and that will define the notion of contractibility. And similarly, I can define what is a Kahn vibration. But no, it's a uniform notion of Kahn vibration. So that's what I write, so the usual existence of one expansion. So it's natural, I mean, to get something constructively. I put extra structure on it so that I get. And with this definition, so I can show that space are closed under exponential in an effective way. An elementary way. I mean, I don't need. Just an example of. I mean, this definition of uniformity, it's actually quite subtle. So, a nice example. So, if I mean, you can show that this F is contractible with this strong definition. Omega is contractible with this uniform definition. So, I is a very interesting example because it's for each I. You can find an extension, but it's impossible to find it in a uniform way. So that's a really nice observation by Christian Sattler. And then you define this, and then I mean the one of the first results that you can check is that if you have a topological space X, topological space, the singular cubical set is fibrant with this strong notion of uniformity. And this is for this, I mean, you take the usual, how do you do this? How do you prove this usually? So you prove that the box is a retract of the field box. And if you look, if you take the most natural proof of this, I mean, this proof is actually uniform in this. Okay, and I think I should stop. So, so that's how you build effectively a model of the, so this will satisfy the univalence axiom in an effective way.
Are your questions?
Yes. Can you show that you get the axioms of the Quillen model category?
Yeah, so that's really interesting. So, I mean, there are people working on this in Leeds. So, Andrew Swan and Christian Sattler and Nicola Gambino. And I think, so I'm not sure actually of the status of this, but I mean, I think they are working on getting an algebraic model structure on this. But this is work in progress.
Yes. And then also, you know, it seems to be related to this work of Christian and Grandis and all that on direct homotopy theory. What I have in mind is that in that theory, you don't have the contractibility of the interval.
Okay. Right. So
I mean, it could be that you do it in such a generality that it would fit with this their approach. Mm-hmm. And why? I mean, if you try to do it with simplicity, what happens?
Yeah, so also Christian Sattler and Nicola Gambino are trying to do with simplices, but, I don't know. No, they have a version where, you do this, but you, what is, instead of F, so they try a generalization where instead of F, you take all decidable mono. So you have also propositions that are decidable, and you try to use only monos that are decidable. And I think so they have similar results that they can prove exponential, but I'm not sure about the axiom of univalence axiom. And for the univalence axiom, what is you use in a crucial way is that actually on this, you can look at F to the I. And you have a kind of elimination of quantifier. So you have a for all, which geometrically is, if you look at this geometrically, it's trivial. You have a for all operation like this. And this is used in the proof of univalence. And I'm not sure if you get, this is also work in progress. And but I think they hope to get, you should be able, this should be independent of the notion of space that you start from, so you expect this to hold.
I would like also to mention that there is a strong form of Heisenberg theorem, which is the category of multi-simplicial objects. So the model as a product of simplicities. A cube, of course, is a product of intervals, one-dimensional simplicities. But you can interpolate it to the general, very general form of Heisenberg construction, which gives that. And so often it is convenient to, well, if you have a good notion for cube, you first try to extend it to multi-simplicial and then back to simplicial. It's one possibility.
I have a comment. This interval is not contractible, but it looks like an interval object in the sense of Vygotsky. There is a notion of site with an interval object, and then you can make it contractible in some canonical way, as Vygotsky showed, in order to construct motives. So, maybe there is an analogy construction in this situation that you can contract this interval and get some category of spectra, some combinatorial spectra, something like that. So, I just want to know if you ever think about it or.
No. Thank you.
So, what about the dream of running proofs? Homotopy type theory.
Yes, so the main application for us, the main application of this is the design of a type system where univalence is provable and where everything computes. So you can compute with it.
So this dream is realized, no?
Hopefully. So we have actually a prototype implementation of this, but.
Do you think it's likely to get a test category on these? Sort of constructive,
you know,
the great
exercise
style.
Yes, so this, I don't know. Sorry. Maybe.